So let's see how we can actually build a smart on FHIR app on top of the Epic Orchard or the Epic App Store. In fact, Epic has access to a lot of FHIR resources in most of their EMRs. And this is a list of all the FHIR resources that they have. Just go to fhir.epic.com and you will have all of these. Now, I already have an account here. You will need to sign up for this account. But once you do, just go to the, there is quite a lot of API specifications and there is a lot of documentation. But for now, we'll be creating an app. So go to the build apps section and I'm just going to create a new app for this particular tutorial. I'm just going to name it tutorial app. And this app is going to be used by the patients. So I'm going to go with the patient app. And all the resources that we want. So for now, I am just going to use the patient resources. So I want patient dot read. I want patient dot search for the FHIR version 4, FHIR R4. If you want something else, you can always like choose that and ask for this. So redirect URI. Now the redirect URI is where your app will come from. And if you haven't seen this already, check out my other video on Smart on FHIR, where I take you through exactly what happens on the flow. Basically, it's OAuth 2 with a little flavor of Smart on FHIR. So if you understand OAuth 2, you will understand what everything is here. So for now, I'm just going to use localhost 3000. So only secured redirect URLs can be used in production. So yeah, make sure to change this to another domain when you're actually pushing this app out. But for this tutorial, I'll just be going with localhost 3000. Okay, so I'm going to just save this. And our app is right now ready. There is quite a bit of things that you need to actually fill out before this app goes into production. But we are right now ready for Sandbox. So let's just take our non-production client ID. And I already have this GitHub repository with me called medblock/smartonfhirview. I'll put a link in the description down below. I'm just going to clone this to my desktop. So I've cloned this, I'm opening this smart on FHIR Vue. So this is a Vue project, but you can always build it in any framework of your choice. So let's take a look at this first. So I'm just going to do and make this a little bigger for you to see. It's too big. So npm install first and install everything that's needed. So there is just a basic Vue Hello World app, and we only have one component, which is the Hello World Vue component. But this contains all of our logic. Okay, so this contains all of our logic, and we will try to exactly see how this works. Now, the client ID here, we are using another client ID for another app, but we just replace it with our own client ID that we generated here. So, generated here. This non-production client ID is what you need to actually use in this case. So, you just replace that here with your own client ID, and then let's take a look at exactly how this app works. So I'm just going to make this a little bigger and clear all this out. npm run dev. So this will open our server in localhost 3000. I'm opening this. So you can see that this just has a little information here about the username and password that we are going to be using. And then there is this sign in button. Although the sign in button seems small, quite a bit of work went into actually constructing the URL here. So the way we generate this URL is by, we have a function here which actually generates the authorize link. And here you can see that it's fhir.epic.com/interconnect-fhir-open-oauth-oauth-2-authorize. And then until authorize, everything is standard OAuth stuff, right? So OAuth has two endpoints. One is the authorize endpoint, the other is the token endpoint. So in this case, we are going to the authorize endpoint, and then we are telling that the response type is code, and all of this is very standard OAuth stuff. And we are telling it the redirect URI, and that's basically going to be either localhost 3000 or this particular domain that I already have deployed if it's in production. Then the state is mandatory. So you just put anything there, that's fine. But if you don't put the state, you'll get an error. So make sure you put the state. And the scope is kind of how we tell OAuth what things are allowed by this particular app. So it will ask us a list of things that we can allow, and we are telling OAuth that, okay, you're telling the Epic server that this app is requesting for these things. So we tell this, although Epic really doesn't respect this scope parameter, we'll see how it looks like. So once all of this is done, we are just taking that and putting it into our sign-in button. So this href, which is the link, is just going to call the authorize link function, and this is going to be returned. So now, once we have the sign-in button, we click on this, and we actually get taken to the FHIR domain as expected. And yep, they have a lot of nice sunflowers and rainbows here. That's cool. So here in the username and password, let's just fill in the test username and password. The way you find this is actually by going to their documentation and checking out all of these things. But for now, I'm just going to show you the sandbox test data. And once you click that, they show you that there are a lot of users available with these particular resources. We are using the FHIR Camellia, which is Camellia Lopez. So this is just a mock user, and they provided the username and password here. And we can just test using this particular user. There is also a practitioner login. You can kind of use this FHIR and Epic FHIR 11 exclamatory mark to test that. There are quite a lot of other users as well. So now let's just go back to our thing. Let's fill out with that particular username and password. The password is this. So once we click sign in, the Epic the Epic EMR then takes us to this whole flow. And since we haven't really verified our app, we didn't really fill out all of those things that it asked us to, it's telling that, you know, they haven't really submitted all of this. Continue. And what type of organization, all that, we didn't do anything. So just continue. And after that, it asks the patient, would you like to allow all these things for this particular app? And we are just going to say yes to that. And once that happens, once we get back, you see that in the redirect URL, there is this particular code. That is actually the access code of our FHIR server. And in fact, if we take a look at this access code, it's actually a JWT, which is a JSON web token. It need not be a JWT in all cases. It can be any token, but in this case, it's a JWT. So we can kind of take a look at what it has. So this JWT tells that they have access, and we have access to this particular subject. And they have other information here as well. Not much really, but yes, they decided to make that a JWT, which is cool. But once we have this access token, what the Vue app does is we first see if there is the token, right? So if there is an access token, so here in this case, there is a Vue directive for the if condition, saying that if the access token is there, and again, this access token is done on the on mounted hook. So here you can see this dot here. So in this dot access token, we are setting it to be the response dot data dot access token. So once we make a post request to the token parameter, we get another access token. So this is the second part of OAuth. So first you do a redirect to authorize, and after you do that, you basically do another request to this token parameter. And I've put in the parameters and the config here, and you can just take a look at this. The whole repository is open source. So once you do that, you then get the actual access token. So now that we have the access token, we can actually make a request to the patient resource. And that's what we are doing here. We are directly going to the FHIR R4 endpoint, putting in the patient and getting this particular patient's ID. And that's also part of the token. So we get that. And here in the authorization header, we put in the bearer token as the access token. So once we do that, we will be able to get access to this whole patient resource. Right. So there are quite a lot of requests being made, and I suggest you just take a look at the network calls that are actually being made. So once I do a full refresh. All right, that didn't work because I probably didn't configure it to work with refreshes. But like, let's see the whole flow right now. I'm just going to preserve the log so we see exactly what's happening. First, I click on sign in, and that takes us to another complete domain, and we use this username and password. And while coming back, I'll show you all the requests, all the different requests that are being made, and we'll see how that fits in with the Smart on Fire protocol. So we just check all of this. Once we click on allow access, we then come back to this again. So unfortunately, this network didn't get captured because the app opened on one tab and it came out to another tab. But yeah, I suggest that you take a look at the code here. Try to see what's happening if you really want to implement this yourself. And the Smart App Launch framework also provides a good bit of documentation on how this works. So this is a standalone launch sequence. So we are doing this full flow, and you can also use any OAuth supported client libraries here. You need not do this manually. So I am doing this manually here to actually teach you how the different parameters need to be set, but you need not do this at all. You can use any client library to do this for you. So that's about it for Smart on Fire and how you build an app on top of the Epic App Orchard. So if you have any questions, please do let me know in the comments down below. And you can always send me an email to Sidharth@medblocks.org.